Welcome to Mark's Tech Talk. This video, we're going to be discussing digital forensics. First of all, what kinds of devices are we interested in terms of digital forensics? Well, first of all, digital forensics is using scientific methodology in order to produce evidence that can be used in a civil or criminal trial. And that evidence may originate on computer hard drives, removable memory such as CDs and DVDs, thumb drives, the flash memory devices. Sometimes residential networks have some storage available that might have some evidence. Any kind of GPS device can locate where a person has been. Digital cameras, really almost anything digital. For example, a lot of criminals will sometimes hide incriminating evidence on game systems. They have hard drives inside a game system and they'll use that for storage. So all of these have to be treated in a forensically sound manner. And that means basically to analyze it without making any modification to that. And that is not a trivial undertaking. Another area that is a real big area for digital evidence are smartphones, and this is really important for a lot of criminal activity, emails and pictures, text messages, even passwords to sites and so forth that might be used in part of a criminal investigation. Really important for law enforcement and then later for prosecution. And all these smartphones must be treated similarly to a computer. Using the digital forensic techniques we're going to discuss in a moment. And as far as importance, think about what happens when a neighborhood drug dealer gets arrested. Typically, drug dealers have multiple smartphones, and each one would have to be analyzed forensically to see if there's any relevant information to the prosecution for that individual. So what are we going to do? Well, first of all, when we acquire the evidence, we've got to be very, very careful with chain of custody. And that is something that's very familiar to the criminal justice folks, but maybe not so much to the people with the computer background. So really, really can't emphasize this enough. Chain of custody really is a log of who has possession of the evidence, and it's proof that the evidence hasn't been tampered with in any way. The evidence itself you can store in an evidence closet or whatever, but don't put it in a plastic bag. You have humidity issues with that. A paper bag would be better, or they have special anti-static bags that can be useful. Also have to be careful, sometimes in police stations or places where there's limited area to store some of this evidence, they'll be tempted to use an electrical closet, and that would not be good for digital evidence. You want to keep it away from any kind of electrical devices, particularly transformers. They're probably the worst offenders. Really want to keep it away from kind of electromagnetic interference of any kind. But again, transformers are a real big one that can actually damage your evidence. Once you go to analyze the digital evidence, the first thing you have to do is always work from an image. And what do we mean by an image? I mean, an image is an exact bit-for-bit copy of the original. You never do any work on the original because you might, in the process of analyzing it, inadvertently make a change to it or in some way damage it. So you want to always work from a copy, and that copy you're working from is called an image, and we'll talk more about that in a moment. As you are doing this process of analyzing the evidence, creating the chain of custody, creating the image, and then doing your analysis, really, really important to document everything you do. Keep a log of everything you've done, because you will not remember this, because by the time that this comes to trial, might be several years later, and if there's appeals, that's even longer, and you're not going to remember any individual case. So it's really important that you have a detailed log, and you document everything you have done. And as I mentioned earlier, maintain that chain of custody. Extremely important. Okay, so these are really imperative in a digital investigation. All right, so what are the steps? We mentioned this idea of an image, a copy of the original image. So how do you do that? Well, you use a special computer where you've removed the hard drive, assuming it's a hard drive you're analyzing or whatever other evidence you're using, a thumb drive or whatever it might be, and you insert between that and the computer system a write protect device, a hardware device that will not allow you to accidentally write over the original evidence. Okay, that's a real key step. You don't want to use software, you want to use a hardware device that physically prevents you from accidentally making any changes to that original evidence. Once you have that in place, then you can create your image file. Now, this is a little bit different than just simply copying a file, or if we're let's use the example of a hard drive. This is typical of what we do. We'll call it the C drive. If you're copying C in the operating system, you simply say copy C. An image is different because you have to copy every single bit on that hard drive, whether it's used or not, whether it contains a file or previously contained a file. And that's a key part there, because some of your evidence may be evidence where a file existed before and then was deleted, and it's possible to recover that. But a normal file copy would not capture that. You have to do a forensic image to capture all of those bits, including the ones that are not currently being utilized. So however big your hard drive is, that's how big of a copy you're going to have. So your forensic computer has to have a lot of memory. You're going to run out of memory very, very quickly with these. It's a huge issue. All right, once you create that image, that copy, then you have to go through a hash analysis. And then we'll do some other steps like a signature analysis. So let's talk some more about that image, first of all, and then the hash analysis. So image is a forensic copy, a bit-for-bit copy of a hard drive or other form of evidence, including unallocated space, erased files, any other information that would be stored on that hard drive, or that was previously stored on that hard drive, or even areas where nothing is stored. All that information must be copied. Once you make that copy, then you do a hash. Now, what do we mean by a hash? A hash is a digital fingerprint of a file. And if you take that fingerprint of the original and then of the copy, if you get the same fingerprint, that means their files are identical. There is no difference between the two files. And that fingerprinting process involves a mathematical algorithm, and you come up with this alphanumeric string of characters, usually it's hexadecimal, and that will uniquely identify that file. And if anything has changed in that file, then that hash code would be different. So if in the process of making your copy, if there was an error and one or two bits were not exactly the same as the original, you would wind up with a different hash code, and you would know that your copy didn't match exactly the original. It's only if your hash codes match, you know you have an exact bit-for-bit copy. Really, really important. Now, there are several different algorithms in use. One common one is called MD5, and we'll talk more about the different versions of hash in just a moment. So once you make that copy, that image of the original, you're going to use that copy to analyze and look for evidence in your case, okay? You never analyze the original source of evidence. And again, I'm using the example of a hard drive here. That original hard drive you never use to do the analysis. That is, you make a one-time copy of your image, and then you do all your analysis on either that copy or a copy of that copy, perhaps a working copy. Never work from the original. All right. So let's get back to this hash. We said it's a digital fingerprint of a file. It's used to detect if two files are the same or if there's a slight difference, or a significant difference for that matter. Some common hash algorithms are the MD5, which stands for Message Digest 5. That produces a 32-bit character string, If you're into computers, it's actually a hexadecimal string. But basically, it's a unique code that identifies that particular file. And if you have the same file, identical, no differences at all, you're going to get the same hash code. If there's a little bit of difference, you get a different hash code. Other types of hash analysis are the SHA-1. SHA stands for Secure Hash Algorithm. There are actually several versions of SHA. SHA-1 is pretty common, but lately they've been moving toward SHA-256 and even SHA-512. And why are we moving on to these? Well, they produce a longer character string, and you're less likely to run into what are called collision issues. And the MD5 does have some collision issues, and that's why it's kind of being phased out, and you see less and less people utilizing that. We'll talk about collisions in just a moment. So, just a reminder, this is really important. Hash analysis is used to verify that your image is the exact copy of the original evidence. And you know that because both the original and the copy have the same hash code. Okay? It verifies that your image file is exact copy. And when I say image, that's just a computer file that is identical to the original, including all this vacant space and erased space and so forth. It has nothing to do with like a picture. Okay, image means something totally different in this context. All right, so we said that MD5 has some issues with a collision. So what is a collision? Well, that's when you have two different files that produce the same hash code. And in theory, that should never happen. Okay, that's if you have a good hash algorithm, that should never happen. Unfortunately, because you're condensing a very large file into just a character string, it is possible. And in fact, the MD5 has been demonstrated a number of times. It's not common, but it can occur. And you really don't want that to occur at all. So that's one of the reasons why the MD5 is becoming less popular and the SHA hash algorithms are becoming a little more popular, because they seem to be a little less susceptible to these collisions. All right, so once you have the image from the original, now you have, again, using the example of the hard drive, perhaps hundreds of thousands of files, part of the operating system, part of your office programs, part of your browsers, part of all the programs that are on a computer. Each program can contain hundreds, or more likely thousands or tens of thousands of individual files that make up that program. So you want to compare that with a library of known files, and that way you can eliminate these files from being interesting from a forensic standpoint. Because if it's a file that's associated with an operating system, well, then there's not going to be any kind of evidence on there. It's just evidence that they have a particular operating system on a computer. It's not really very interesting. You're looking for something that is interesting from your investigation perspective, that contains some incriminating information or something like that. So what you do is you compare the hash code from all the files on that hard drive, actually the image of the hard drive, to this library of known files. In other words, every computer operating system, you know, let's just say it has 10,000 files. Well, somebody has previously got the hash code for each of those 10,000 files. And you can compare your result in hash code with those to see if any of those files have been modified. And you do that with all the programs on there. You compare the hashes from all the files on your evidence image file with the known innocent hash codes from programs and so forth. And that will eliminate, you know, easily 90% of the files that are on a hard drive. And now you only have to look at what was probably the documents and things like that that were created in the course of using the computer. Those will be unique to that computer, and those are the ones where you're likely to find evidence. So this process removes from part of the investigation, your known files, the operating system files, the office files, the browser files, and all those, and will flag the files that perhaps might be named the same, but don't have the same content. So again, a criminal sometimes will name the file as the same as a file that is normally part of, let's say, the operating system, but really doesn't get used or doesn't get used very often. They'll kind of rename their file to match that, to make it look like it belongs as part of the operating system, when in fact it's hiding evidence. So this hash will kind of red flag those files and say, hey, you know, I know this has a name of a file that's part of the operating system, but it doesn't have the right content. So that's real advantage of hash analysis. Kind of going hand in hand with that hash analysis is something called signature analysis. And this is where you're comparing the structure of a file with its extension. For example, if it's a Word document, the file will have an extension DOCX, okay? But perhaps somebody has taken a picture and renamed it and changed that extension to say DOCX because they didn't want you to see that picture. And maybe you're doing a search looking for certain pictures. And this is gonna look like a big Word document. But if you do a signature analysis, it's going to red flag that and say, hey, wait a minute, this is labeled as being a Word document, but it's not, it's something else. In our example, it might be an image file. Conversely, you could do just the opposite. It could be labeled as a JPEG or something like that, really be a Word document, or any other kind of file. And again, criminals will do things like this in order to hide the existence of these files, to make it look like these files are innocent files. It obscures their existence. Deleted files is another thing that you have to be looking for in an investigation. There is software that can be used to, quote, undelete. Matter of fact, some operating systems will do this, but certainly your forensic software will do this. Forensic software will look and actually try to recover information that has been deleted, and some cases actually recover information that has actually been written over in many cases several times, and it can get the underlying information. It's possible to recover data that has been written over many, many times, sometimes with software, but sometimes it's really you have to go to the physical level and actually look at the magnetized areas using an electron microscope. That's not something you're going to do in a normal investigation. That would be extremely costly and extremely time-consuming, but it is possible to do. So that's not something normally part of the process, but it's something you should be aware of, that it is not out of the realm of possibility. For example, if you're looking at some very high-value terrorists or something like that, as the federal government wants to know what they're planning or something along those lines, they may be using a process like this. This would not be used in a normal investigation. Another place criminals will hide incriminating information is in what are called SLAC files. In order to understand SLAC files, you have to understand how computers store information. When they store information on a hard drive or any memory, they always store it in equal-sized chunks. So for example, if you think of it as people living in a house, if all the houses were the same, it's easier to move families from one house to another because all of them are the same. But one house might have one person in it, and next house may have three people in it. So you can store in these blocks, these digital blocks, again, akin to a house, you can store different amounts of information, which would be like how many people are living in a house. So you have the same block size, the same allocated bunch of memory, this block of memory, and within that you store whatever you need to store. And there's going to be a difference between the size needed to store it and the actual size allocated. And that difference is called the slack space. Here's an illustration of slack space. You can see the gray rectangular areas are the blocks of information that are allocated by the computer. And the blue rectangles represent the actual size of the information that's recorded. So for example, here you have some leftover space, and that leftover space is called the slack space. Here's another area where you have a little bit of extra space. That's called the slack space. And again, here, a little bit of leftover area, there is the slack space. And then we can move over here, some slack space here, some additional slack space on top here, and so on and so forth. So sometimes it's a little bit of space, sometimes it's quite a bit of space, but all of this is slack space that you normally cannot see the contents of. The computer operating system will ignore this because it thinks that the darker blue is the only area that has information, when in fact you're kind of getting around the operating system and hiding this in this unused area. So that's something else that forensic software can help you with. It will look at the contents of that slack space and see, is that a file that has previously been deleted? Is that a complete file that somebody hid there? Whatever, it's going to be looking at that slack space. And that's something that wouldn't be copied with a normal copy procedure, but would be copied with a forensic image. So that's why it's really important in your forensic image to copy all of the bits, including, for example, this slack space. So another thing to point out in terms of forensic analysis is emails. A lot of evidence revolves around emails, and it's really, really difficult to destroy an email. One of the reasons is because it exists in several different places. If you send an email, there's going to be a copy of that email on your computer. There's going to be a copy on the server of your ISP. There's going to be a copy on the server of the recipient's ISP. And there's going to be a copy on the recipient's computer. So there's going to be at least four copies of that email out there, perhaps more. And if you remove that and you delete that from your PC, well, there's three additional copies still out there. Very, very difficult to remove it from all locations. And even from your own PC, because you can recover information that's been deleted, it's pretty common that you can actually recover those deleted emails just from your PC without even having to look at those multiple copies. And a number of subjects of investigation have found out the hard way that it's very difficult to totally remove these emails. So that's really important to understand from a forensic standpoint. Another thing you should understand from a forensic standpoint is something called metadata. Metadata is additional information about a file. So when a computer writes a file, it usually creates a kind of a header, if you will, of when that file was created, sometimes when it was last opened, if it's an email, who was copied on it. If it's a picture, it may include at what time the picture was taken, what kind of camera was used to capture the picture. Oftentimes, we'll even include the GPS coordinates of where the picture was taken. So there's a lot of information that can be had by looking at the metadata. And sometimes you can look at least some of that information fairly easily with regular computer programs, but you can certainly look at all of the information and all the details using a forensic program. So what forensics programs are you going to use? Well, if you're using a PC, the two most popular software tools are FTK and InCase. FTK stands for Forensic Toolkit. And InCase is a commercial product by Guidance Software. Those are two most popular forensic software tools for PCs. For cell phones, the real popular ones are Cellbrite and Parabin. Just again, two popular commercial products for analyzing contents of cell phones. So that's it for this edition of Mark's Tech Talk. I hope you enjoyed it, and I hope you stay tuned for more.